Well, welcome back. This is Chrissy McMahon, and you're live with me tonight on awakeradio.co.uk. We're also on shaziz.com, and we are on weroar.ws. And I want to thank April Rain for the opportunity to broadcast live for the next 2 hours, and also Shaziz and Beverly and everybody at Shaziz Radio, and give my highest regard to my wonderful friends at Awake Radio for providing this wonderful platform to share the truth that nobody wants to hear but us. And tonight I have a very special guest. I have Vinny Eastwood, straight from New Zealand. Vinny, he's the sponsor, the creator, the wonderful entity of the Vinny Eastwood Show, aka Mr. News, was born in the ominous year of 1984, the same year set out in Orwell's masterpiece and the year of New Zealand's neoliberal economic reforms. After working in the telecommunications industry, he quit when he noticed that when he lied to a customer, the company's profits margins went up. Unable to work or have an employer in the conventional sense, Vincent went out with frustration at the mainstream media and began to make his own news by interviewing activists about real issues that truly affect New Zealand and the world. The idea is to get the activists who live and breathe the issues and are not bound by corporate or political parties to be the pundits, reporters, and watchdogs on the multifaceted agendas of the global elite right here at home. He hopes to one day be part of an alternative media revolution that will replace the mainstream media with something that's relevant. Well, I think we're on the verge of that, Vinny. What do you say? Welcome, Vinny.
Yeah, good day, Chrissy. Sorry, I'm just eating a pear right now because I just did my show and it's lunchtime now and so on and so forth. So if I sound like I'm a mouth full of something, it is. It's not full of BS, though.
Awesome. Well, welcome. I finished chewing, and I'll keep reading this wonderful
bio.
Well, there's more, and not only is it a bio, you have, what is it? You have principles for your website, for your life, for your show.
Did you know why the government had to close down all the public schools?
No, why?
Because they didn't have any principles.
Oh yeah, and I forgot, a quick wit. We have one of the quickest wits in New Zealand ever to be on internet radio right here live tonight.
Well, it's the other thing as well. I put up a new Facebook photo, and behind me in the photo, like, I've got the little GoPro camera out here in front of me on a little mechanical arm kind of thing. One of my listeners sent to me. Indeed, the listener brought the GoPro for me as well. And behind me, there's a person holding up a sign that says, "I'm a once proud Kiwi, now ashamed." And somebody asked me, you know, "Vinny, why did you include that sign back there? Why don't you just have your own picture and that kind of thing?" And I say, "Because it's very true.
Mm-hmm.
There's 5 million Kiwis worldwide, 4 million in New Zealand, and I'm the only one with a 5-day-a-week radio show telling the truth. I'm the only one with a top-ranked YouTube channel that has more subscribers than every single mainstream media outlet in New Zealand. I'm the only one. And that doesn't make me proud to be the only one. It makes me ashamed of my countrymen."
Okay, you're going to kill me.
Am I?
Yeah, you are. I had my vax set wrong on Skype. So try now. They're telling me they can't hear you, which is devastating.
Really?
That's the reason why we're here today. So, yeah, I'm not getting any feedback.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, but I'm listening on Skype. I'm not listening over the air, so that's part of it.
Isn't this broadcast happening through Skype?
Yeah, it's actually being recorded on the encoder, I hope. Woohoo!
Okay.
We can hear you now. Okay, I fixed it. Yeah, I had it on my other speakers, gosh. Yeah, they hire novices to do this. Did you know that? they don't really hire professionals to do this internet radio stuff, so we get all
kinds
of technical
issues. Hold on, you're hired?
Well,
they're hired?
I volunteered willingly, and they accept it. I even did a test. I did a test spot, and it was so good, they let me stay.
Yeah. And just remember, obviously, you've got to keep that microphone down underneath your chin there, otherwise you get that sound coming through. And as part of what I like to do, actually, is teach activists how to be their own media personalities and how to get out there. Because what I found very interesting about all these activists, like, you see them on the news all the time, and they have what I call audio nibbles, where there's like a very, very tiny little skerrick of information that they put out for people amidst all the BS. And when I started seven odd years ago, I think going out with a camera and interviewing these people, it started to blow my mind just what incredible speakers they were and how much information they were capable of laying out, to the point where I was starting to have like 2, 3, 4, 5 hour conversations with these kind of people and never running out of things to say. And I was like, whoa, this is the amount of information that's being cut out of the media. And the reporters here are just total douchebags. I mean, it's like I interviewed Ian Wishart, who wrote the book Aircon. He runs Investigate Magazine .com here in New Zealand. He was one of New Zealand's most credible journalists. He was the host of the Sunday program, which is our equivalent to 60 Minutes. And he told me on air that reporters are airheads. They're idiots.
Talking heads.
And so naturally, the news that you get is tailored for idiots. So it's music. You know how they say, we the people, you know, a government of, by, and for the people? Well, the media is media of, by, and for idiots.
Yeah, pretty much.
They occasionally interview intelligent people, which is why those intelligent people never get a look in for more than a 5 second statement in order to encapsulate something. And it just made me so angry, you know, because these activists and so on and so forth. Activist is actually a dirty word. Did you know that? Like, oh, you're one of these activists. You're one of these professional protesters. You're trying to save the country from ruthless criminal scum that are taking away everybody's rights and indebting us further into complete and total global slavery and soft-kill bioweapons and everything like that. You should go get a job. You should go get a job and be a slave like me.
Yeah, we have a guy, Steve Hope, and he said this is the only place where, like, you're slaves and you have to pay for it. I mean, and we all sit there, we want to laugh, but it's not funny. It's not even funny. It was true.
Well, you know,
they're paying for our own slavery.
Yeah, and that is the case. But the thing is, if it ain't funny, then you've got to invent something that is funny in the meantime. Otherwise, it'll drive you nuts. And that's the tagline of my show. It's the lighter side of genocide, because in a world so full of chaos and madness, if you lose your sense of humor, you'll go friggin' nuts. Yeah. And I came to that conclusion when I was curling into fetal positions and crying and yelling at all my relatives and so on and so forth. 9/11 was an inside job! Oh, my God! We're all being killed by self-killed bioweapon from the Rockefeller Rothschild cartel. Oh, God. And then I just realized, oh, my God, I'm losing my sanity because I've just got no sense of humor about this. How do people who work as, say, surgeons or triage units and so on and so forth deal with the horrible crap that they see day in and day out? You ever seen the TV show Scrubs?
Yeah, actually. My kids love it. They watch that all the time.
Yeah. Right, even though they're dealing with a lot of serious, you know, things. And there was a great line in there by Dr. Cox when he's saying to him, look at that family in there. Now, the doctor is telling them that their father is dying, okay, and he has to go back to work after that. Do you think any of the members of that family are going back to work after hearing that? No. Yeah. And that's why we make jokes. Not because it's fun, but because it's the only way to deal with this this job, and sometimes because it's fun.
Yeah, and we found that that's probably the best way to reach people. I had a show last Sunday, and I had a woman, Carolyn Rose Goida, on Facebook. I don't know if you know her, but she's really funny, and she's really knowledgeable. And we just had a wonderful, like, three-hour conversation. There was four of us, and it was just amazing, the levity and the seriousness of all these issues and how connected they are. It's just unbelievable. And I know when I first started this, I was beating people over the head with it. And I was calling them sheeple and all that other stuff. And I totally turned around a 180 and just try to share when people are open to it. You know, once in a while I screw up, and like I got a bad tip the other day because I told some Republicans that there was alternative energy sources. I mean, like 100 years ago, Tesla made wireless. And they asked me if I was a Democrat because they're like really into the Marcellus Shale project. They think people are making a lot of money. They're all excited because they think it's wonderful for jobs and the economy, and they can't even see the devastation because they know it's never been proven that anybody's been harmed by the fracking process. So it's just, you know, when I got the tip, I knew right away. It was like, at least I got to say. And I know her husband was kind of open to what I was saying, but she wasn't. And I kind of thought the next day, well, maybe she's one of those reptilians they talk about. And I just couldn't see the shape shifting. But yeah, that's what I thought.
Well, I look at it like this. The reptilian phenomenon, or the theory of it, because as far as I know, nobody's captured one yet and dissected them to see what's really underneath their skin or whatever. So it's not been proven yet. But there have been many, many things that were theorized before they were able to be proven. Bacteria, for example. Why are half the people that we're doing really roughshod surgery on with rusty knives and unwashed hands all dying? Well, I theorize that there's these incredibly small creatures called bacteria that get into the wounds and cause disease. And then all the doctors go, oh, you're freaking crazy. Throw them in the nut house. And sure enough, he got thrown in the nut house. And then when they started using soap and washing their freaking hands before they put their hands inside people's freaking cavity, then they found out that the people stopped getting disease, and they go, well, he must have been right. And then about, I don't know, 20 or 30 years later or whatever, however long a period of time it took, they invented this thing called a microscope, and then they were able to see that these bacteria and microorganisms really did exist. So just because something's theorized and hasn't been proven doesn't mean it doesn't exist, and it doesn't mean that the person is Looney Tunes. However, is it relevant? A friend of mine, Mike, he started to hear about the reptilian agenda, you know, and we were sitting in the car, and he was kind of freaking out. It's like, oh my God, Vinny, these reptilians, they're scary. They're trying to enslave and kill us. And I go, okay, have you ever seen one? No. So you're sitting there and you're actually actively afraid by something you have never seen, have never been affected by, and may never be. Worry about the things that are right in front of you first. Once you don't have to stop worrying about that, then you can start looking further. You know, sure, be a little bit aware that there's this theory floating around out there. But what I find very interesting is the nexus point between what a reptilian shapeshifter allegedly actually is and what a psychopath is. And you find out that they're virtually the exact same thing. We have alleged documented evidence of pictures of these microorganisms that attach themselves to the brain stems of people and actually start controlling them, much like a car. And it becomes apparent that we're not dealing with some kind of mental disorder here. We're actually dealing with a mind parasite, something that is actually capable of infecting you, replicating itself, that needs human energy. It needs fear It needs an entourage. It needs power. It needs control. It needs deception in order to survive. You put a psychopath on a desert island with nobody else around, doesn't matter how much coconuts and pineapples the person can eat there, he'll die within a matter of days, because they actually do need to feed off of our negative energy. That, I think, is a very profound realization, because then you think about it. American Medical Journal states that a psychopath is a person who is very enchanting. Very enchanting when you first meet them, but after a while you realize that they have no long-term relationships and they don't care about anything other than themselves. And I think back for when I used to work for people, and now I work for myself and I work for humanity. It's like, man, that's like every single employer that I've ever had. And the American Medical Journal went on to further say that there are three likely industries that you can find these people: business, media, and politics. On top of that, religious gurus, doctors, and lawyers. What would you say are the main apparatus of society that keeps people under control and gives people power? It would be all those industries, wouldn't it? Comprised together. And then when you think about it, you look at society, you look at where society's going. Is there a lot of deception going on? Yeah. Is there a lot of cruelty going on? Yeah. Is there a lack of self-analysis going on here? Yeah. Is there a lot of crime being committed? Yeah. Is there a lack of justice everywhere? Yeah. Is the power and control centers growing and weaseling its way into people's lives so that it can become inescapable? Yeah. That's because society is run by psychopaths. Okay?
Right. Mm-hmm.
They love power and control, so they wind up getting their way to the top somehow or another. Most psychopaths will never actually commit a crime in their entire life. But just because you're not committing a crime doesn't mean you're doing something moral. Doesn't mean you're doing something ethical. For example, fluoridation. Fluoride is a toxic waste product. Okay, you can look it up. Monofluorohexasilicate. Sounds like a big long word. Basically, it's a one of the worst poisons that you could ever conceive of in your entire life. Used as a rat poison. It eats through metal. Oh, no, sorry. It eats through concrete. It eats through glass. Okay. It's used as a chemical weapon. In fact, the chemical weapon attack in Syria...
Thank you.
...was potassium fluoride and sodium fluoride. So, legally speaking, when you sell a toxic waste product to a municipality, legally, it becomes reclassified, instead of toxic waste, to being classified as a product. It's illegal to dump toxic waste, but it's not illegal to dump a product into the water supply. So they've broken no laws, yet they're being deceptive, manipulative, and downright evil.
And with the Clean Air Act, they can make their own rules. They there's no oversight. There's no anything in our legal system to stop them from even doing that.
There's no recourse.
Abomination, yeah.
Yeah, and that's what the United States has now turned into, an Obama nation.
Very well said.
Now, is anybody else concerned? Because what happens is you then, guilt by association. Because I talk about fluoride, and this actually happened to me, a bunch of socialists invited me around to their place. They're having a campfire in the backyard, you know, singing a few songs and having a few beers. And I started telling this person there's actually two types of fluoride. There's sodium fluoride, which is the toxic waste product, and calcium fluoride, which is caused by water rushing over limestone and collecting up certain calcium deposits into the fluoride, okay, which is actually not that bad for your teeth. And because I mentioned that there were these two different types of fluoride, lady across the fire said to me, "Oh, you're going to be talking about reptilian shapeshifters next." Is there a connection between reptilian shapeshifters and fluoride that's just so obvious? Because obviously anybody who talks about a particular chemical compound is differences between different chemical compounds is obviously somebody who is completely and utterly crazy and believes in things that aren't true at all whatsoever with zero evidence. See. And so I mean, it's the insanity of it. If you look at society and you think that it doesn't make sense to you, that's because you're not a psychopath. If you were a ruthless, horrific, cruel, empathy-lacking parasite on humanity, everything would make sense to you. The medical system being the second leading cause of death makes sense to you. The military invading countries that with zero justification and never having any charges brought against the leaders who put said incursions into actions makes total sense to you. If you're a good, decent person, on the other hand, it starts to drive you a little bit crazy. Mm-hmm. And interestingly enough, this psychopathic parasite of which I speak turns out that it's actually infectious. If you're hanging out with psychopaths, you become what's known as a proto-psychopath. And they actually use their power of deception and manipulation to turn you into one of them. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that freaking scary?
Yeah.
And it's like radiation or toxic garbage or whatever. There really isn't anything that you can do to clear it up, but you can stay the frack away from it. Okay? There've been people who've been foolish in history who say, "This person's a psychopath, I'm going to expose them. I'm going to go after them." Now, if you do that, you've got rules that you follow, okay? So, for example, you wouldn't kill or torture or rape children, for example. You're going after a psychopath. Psychopath will be very, very upset with you, and he will, conceivably, if he can get away with it, kill, rape, and torture your children in order to get back at you, okay? Right. That is the reason why you can't deal with these people. Don't do business with them. Don't talk to them. Don't message them back on Facebook. Don't do anything. And here's another thing. They can never apologize.
Right.
All right. You know somebody who can never admit who can never apologize? And when they do apologize, they say, "Well, I'm sorry you feel that way." Very false apologetic stance that they've got there. These are the kind of people who are the toxins, the parasites on society, and you need to get them the frack out of your life because there is no benefit in it, okay? The other element here is that if evil exists, surely so does good. And I don't know about you, Chrissy, but I've been sort of thinking about like Knights of the Round Table, you know, honor, bravery, truth, these very pure motives that I have are the antithesis to this kind of psychopathic system. In so doing, that means that every moment that I embody these particular elements of which that I speak, I am actually thwarting and taking over the system in my own little way. And I think we all need to recognize the power of choice, of how we can truly make a difference if we start believing that we can. Mm-hmm. All right. So, like, Vietnam veterans, for example, in the POW camps, they had a much higher survival rate in a POW camps when they were locked away, being tortured daily, malnourished, in a prison camp, nobody to keep them company, nobody to give them comfort, no hope of rescue. The ones that survived that conditions were, moreover, those who had a strong belief in God. Isn't that interesting? Even if you don't think that God exists, just believing that he does means that when you're completely alone and you've got absolutely no hope, you're not alone and you have hope. And just having that belief that something better can happen for you, just having that belief that there is something above you, something that is not part of you, that is detached from you, that is still there with you at all times. Just that belief in and of itself, regardless of the religious context, increases your ability of survival in tough situations. And to my mind, this actually kind of connotes that the human being is an incredibly powerful creature. We have abilities far beyond what we even think that we're possibly capable of. How much percentage of our brains do we use? I mean, in America nowadays, it's like, what, 1% in the general population are capable of using their brains, maybe? I don't know. In New Zealand, it's probably not that dissimilar, because we all have really dumbed down, brainwashed populations. Yet, we're still capable, despite all the odds, of waking up to the truth, of having power, despite the huge quantity of scumbaggery that tries to misinform us, misdirect us, and misrepresent us. That gives me hope, just looking at the examples of history, just looking at this. A lot of people say that one person can't make a difference. Really? Who's Gandhi? Well, he's a guy who freed India against the British Empire. Okay. Who's George Washington? Oh, he's a guy who led an army to free the United States from the tyranny of the British Empire. Okay. Who's Hugo Chavez? Oh, he's a guy who threw the American Empire out of Venezuela and gave oil profits back to the people and so on and so forth. Okay. Who's? Do you see what I'm getting at here? Traditionally, one person has been the only thing that makes a difference. And I think the New World Order knows that, and they want to make people believe the opposite, that you have to get help in order to get anything accomplished in your life. That mentality, to me, is completely insane. The worst thing that you can do if you want to accomplish something great when you're first starting off is ask other people for help.
Okay. Well, with that said, I want to paraphrase this because I think it's real important. I think one of the other tools is the duality. I think there's a lot of trying to keep the us and them, black and white, separate us. And a lot of people don't understand that construct because they see something that they believe in their own mind to be wrong, and they want to make it right. They can't agree to disagree, or you know, things like that. So with that said, and I have no idea what this question means. If you'll look in your Skype chat, someone sent a question from We Roar, and it's from April Rain, I believe, and the question goes, speaking of parasites, what's the truth regarding what really happened between you, Vinny, and Pete Santilli? Is that his name? I don't even know who he is, so I don't know what the situation is. But I this is one of the constructs. You know, we have all these things going on that are so wrong in the world, but we're gonna microscope on one little aspect of something that really doesn't have anything to do with the greater purpose of solutions. So, and that divides us, and that keeps us separate. So, you know, maybe you can clarify that better. So, go ahead.
Honestly, I don't want to because, as I said before, if you're involved with a psychopath, the worst thing that you can do is continue to have any form of interaction with them. And if I were to say on live radio what I truly think about Pete Santilli or what he did to me, one of his listeners will quite likely send him that information and the attacks will begin anew.
That's not why we're here. We're not here to do that. That's not the purpose of this conversation, was to do what you've started from the very beginning, is point out the obvious and try to enlighten people to the bigger reality of what's really going on here. And I think you're doing an excellent job. There's a lot of people on the Awake chat line that are, you know, giving you the thumbs up and saying, right on, Vinny. So, and I apologize, because I'm very ignorant to that stuff. And
No, that's cool,
like
that's cool.
To me, and I don't get into that, so I'm sorry.
I can explain generally, because we had a number of discussions, a couple of roundtable discussions on psychopaths on my radio program. So if you go to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Vincent Eastwood, and you search, and if you search psychopath roundtable, the elements that we discuss in there, all the methodologies of psychopaths, all of the things that they do to people that they target and so on and so forth, is exactly the answers to the question that listener is looking for. And the panelists didn't know this at the time, about me and my experience with this. But what was interesting is that they didn't need to know the backstory. They laid out in detail how psychopaths act, how they treat people, and it was almost word for word, 100% mirror image of what happened to me. Okay, so yeah, Psychopath Roundtable, Vinny Eastwood. If you search that on YouTube, it should come up with it, and that'll clarify a lot of things for you. And also, there is a Pete Santilli Exposed video that myself and Suzanne Posel did, which was uploaded by Laurie of Laurie's News Talk Radio, I think. So you can search that on YouTube as well, and we did like an hour-long explanation of the incident. So, you know, the information's out there, but, you know, the thing is, I don't want to tie you into it as well, Chrissy. I feel really uncomfortable talking about it. As far as I'm concerned, it's out of my life, and I don't want to have anything to do with it anymore. I started Guerrilla Media in 2007, and it's mine. It's my idea. It's my concept. It's my construct. I've put a lot of work into it. And guess who else has something called Guerrilla Media after they talked to me and asked me for all my ideas on it and so on and so forth and set it up.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, and I have people that I would term not sociopaths or psychopaths, but narcissists. And when you were talking about it being communicative, I'm thinking maybe genetic, but my mother is definitely narcissistic, and for the longest time I had no idea. I always, like, because I was a little kid, and I always thought I was doing something wrong. And my mother's a person who can never say she's sorry. And I wouldn't go so far as to call her a psychopath, because my mother's done a lot of amazing, wonderful, good things in her life. But there is this part of her that's very narcissistic. And I just recently became aware of it. So there's different levels of this behavior. And, you know, you can look it up on the internet. That's how I found out. So, you know, I don't know what that has to do with anything.
Well, it actually has to do with a lot. All psychopaths are narcissists, but not all narcissists are psychopaths. I'm a narcissist, actually. This may surprise you. Okay, what's a narcissist? Okay, have you heard of Muhammad Ali?
Yeah.
float like a butterfly, stink like a bee. I'm Muhammad Ali, and I'm going to beat the crap out of ye. All right, you know what I'm saying here? A guy who believes in himself, loves himself, and believes that he is the greatest that has ever been, not because he was deluded, but because he was correct. That's what you call a benign narcissist. I believe that I'm a great speaker, a great radio show host. I believe that I'm a good man. I believe that I'm capable of great things. I believe that I can contribute to the world and making it a better place, a place that is more accepting of people's differences and their different capabilities, and bringing those capabilities out in people to tutor, to help people learn, to accept who they are and what they are really capable of, you know? Mm-hmm. And I'm relatively egotistical. You can't be a radio show host without at least having just a little bit of an ego. But I'm not a bad person. I do overwhelmingly good things. Even though I think very highly of myself, I'm also very down on myself a lot of times. And indeed, my listeners can hear it in my voice sometimes. And often will call me up on Skype after the show or something and go, Vinny, you sounded really depressed on the air. Are you okay or whatever? And I'll talk about myself for a while or whatever. And they talk about themselves and we have a conversation. They talk about themselves. I talk about myself, and we listen to each other. Okay, that's an equal, open, loving, caring conversation, and it makes me feel better enough to forget about the fact that I was depressed about whatever scumbag did whatever to me. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So there's nothing necessarily bad about being a narcissist, just as long as you don't let it go to your head and you have other good, decent people out there who are not yes men, who will tell you when you're being a bit of a dick.
Okay, here we have another question. Do you know of another country where people are more free than in the United States? And if so, which ones? Or one? There's no country people are free.
Communist China. Communist China.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here's how you tell.
In communist China, 10% of the people are unemployed and 10% of people are below the poverty line. In the United States, 6% of people are unemployed and 18% of people are below the poverty line. Okay? And in China, they have about a few million people or something in prison, work camps and so on and so forth. In the United States, you have more prisoners, not per capita, but actual in numbers. You have more people in prison with like less than half the population of China than China does. You execute more people than every single other country that executes people combined.
Right.
You are surveilled more than every other single country in the entire world. So if you want to ask me what country is freer than the United States, I would ask you, what country isn't?
Well, yeah, that was my thought when I read the question. I'm like, some people are under the illusion that we do have freedom, but that's okay. You know, you're entitled to your own opinion, but, you know, sometimes you have to do a little bit deeper digging to find out, you know, just how true your belief system is, and where do you get that construct? Where does it come from? You know, where's the information that you're basing this on? So, yeah, that was a great question. Yeah,
it was. And it highlights a very important thing, isn't it? There's no such thing as a free nation in a new world order, is there?
Right.
The bankers control every nation, pretty much, at the end of the day. There's no escape from it. I liken it to a Zeppelin. And like the Hindenburg, for example, when they anchor Zeppelins, they have to throw ropes on them on various corners all around it, so that it doesn't matter how many of the ropes and everything get cut, the Zeppelin ain't going to fly away because there's always other ropes and everything all around it. And what happens is, if you want to free your nation, you are held down by the ropes of every other single nation that's under the control of the bankers, under every single other corporation that's under control of the Rockefellers, Rothschilds, you know, whatever you want to call it. So in order for any nation to be free, truly free, every single nation would have to be freed simultaneously. The bankers would have to be disabled, in other words, simultaneously, because you can't leave them alone and think that you're going to be free, because they will come for you again. They are ruthless. They want this New World Order system. They want total control of all human life. They want control of you from birth. They want to pump you full of vaccines. They want to give you a birth certificate, which has a shipping number, so that they can trade you on as a commodity, like livestock. Mm-hmm. You know? You ever think about that?
Yeah, we have that.
And on top of that, every time that you open your mouth and speak out against the system, they want all of the other brainwashed morons around you that have been totally mind controlled since they were born to tell you that you're crazy, to ostracize you.
Yeah,
suddenly you'll find yourself without, you'll find out that you've suddenly got no friends, because all of your friends that you thought were your allies, that you thought were actually loyal to you because you've been a good friend to them and so on and so forth, have no loyalty to you whatsoever. Mm. They have loyalty to one thing and one thing only, the state. Mm. And the state has no loyalty to its citizens whatsoever, yet it demands loyalty from every single one of its citizens. You know, that's the very definition of hypocrisy. Do as I do, do as I say, but not as I do. And people forget that. People forget that in the 20th century, more people were killed by their own government than any other factor. More people under communist regimes died in the 20th century by their own government's hand than all the wars of the 20th century combined. The government is not there to help you. It's not there to serve you. It is there to kill, enslave, and use you as a serf on the plantation. Just because you're capable of walking around the different fields in the plantation without being stopped by your slave master with a whip doesn't mean you're free, because you're still a slave. You're still owned. I had a feminist try and argue this point with me. And I said to her, look, I know you think you're free, that your kids are going to, some of them are going to university or whatever, and that you're still together with your husband, that you've got a home and so on and so forth. Well, let me ask you this. Do you pay taxes that you never got a choice in whether or not you pay them?
Yeah.
Are your children being forcibly indoctrinated for 6+ hours a day at a state school? Yeah. If the answer to either or even a single one of those questions is yes, then you're a slave. And it doesn't matter what rationalization that you put up. That is what you are. And you must accept the fact that you are a slave, because the one who is most enslaved is the one who falsely believes that they are free. I believe wholeheartedly that I'm a slave. And so that means I am now on the path to becoming free. Much like an alcoholic must admit that they are an alcoholic before they go on the path to sobriety.
Okay, we have a couple more questions. We'll take them one at a time. The first one is, if Finney could do one thing that would, I guess, rid the world of the USA World Police, what would it be? I think telling people what's going on is helpful.
Death and murder is never helpful in my opinion, in a lot of ways, because it always leads to just more death and murder. You know, you got the old examples. One thing to remove the US war machine. Well, basically, you cut funding to the Department of Defense down to zero. Done. Next question.
Here, let me. Besides educating, talking to people, what viable actions does Vinny take to stop the NWO?
Well, let's see. I eat organic food. I buy non-fluoridated water. I use coconut oil and baking soda deodorants. What else do I do? I try to exercise. I try to minimize my amount of exposure to television. I care about other people enough to do things for them where I will get no reward. I attend protests and bring the technology so that the people's voices may be heard. I mean, everything that I've got has been donated, and one of which is a 100-watt megaphone. The police use 25-watt megaphones, and I've got a 100-watt megaphone with a wireless microphone. Okay? You can hear my voice booming down Queen Street in Auckland here, you know. And, what else do I do? I've stopped using processed sugar. I'm starting to use coconut sugar. The New World Order is all-encompassing, so that the second you wake up, even while you're asleep, you are completely surrounded by scumbaggery of the New World Order. And it's a long process. Okay, so here's point A, where every single thing that you do in your entire life serves the New World Order agenda. And here is part Z, or Z for the New Zealanders listening, where you are living your life completely out of their control. You are not in any way supporting your system. Because, and I'm not, there's a reason why I did A to Z instead of A to B, because it's not just a one-step, two-step program, okay? It takes decades, one by one, of getting the New World Order the frack out of your life, okay? I'm still paying taxes, because you can't not pay taxes in New Zealand. You go to any store, they automatically tax every single thing that you purchase. And it's the same in most other countries. There's no escape for it. I pay my vehicle registrations, because if I don't pay my vehicle registrations, then I'll have these fascist cop scum pulling me over all the time. I really hate cops. Not good cops, of course. There's like two or three of them, I'm sure, in the police force. If that. And I don't like having any interactions to them. So I don't like having to do these things, but I make a rationalization by saying, you know what? I can do a hell of a lot more by being able to go around without being stopped. I can do a lot more without having my home raided by IRD, the New Zealand equivalent of the IRS, by paying my taxes, than I could if I had to deal with all that stuff myself. And the reason why I rationalize it like that is because for 2 hours a day, 5 days a week, I'm running the Vinnie Eastwood show, and I'm bringing on a new guest almost every single day, talking about a new topic almost every single day that previously people may not have heard about. And we're living in a time now where we're so ill-informed about everything that unless you start listening and learning about everything, every aspect of your life, every function of every organ in your body, every aspect of the apparatus of the New World Order, unless you are willing to take a fully eclectic, holistic, long-term view of the entirety of the system without leaving anything out, there will be no possibility that we will, as I said before, release the zeppelin of freedom amidst the ropes of tyranny.
Okay, that's one beautiful. I totally agree. And here's another question. If they shut down the internet tomorrow, what tools would Vinny use to communicate with others? And that's an easy one.
I would burn DVDs. I would go on live terrestrial radio. I would be I would go into print media. I would probably be doing a lot more work with my friend Jonathan Eisen from Uncensored Magazine here. I would be doing all sorts of things. The internet is the thing is, what happened a couple of, I think like last week, is my Facebook account that I've been working on for 6-7 years. Okay.
got shut down by Facebook, and I cannot get back into it. Trust me, everybody's now suddenly got suggestions of, oh, but you can do, can lay complaints and so on and so forth. Trust me, I have tried every conceivable possible way to get that account unrevoked.
No response,
no ability to even make a complaint, because in order to make it, you've got to log in with the account, and I can't log in with the account until I change, which we do. So I've been completely fracked. And when I get upset, it's very scary for people. You know, I'm 6'4". I have a very loud voice. I have a propensity for profanity. It's like age monster comes out, and it's actually terrifying for people around me to see me kind of like lose control. And I did pretty much almost lose control when every single post that I've ever made, every friend that I've ever accepted, every group that I ever created, every page that I'm an admin on with tens of thousands of likes and so on and so forth that I share my show on every single day is gone forever. And then I realized, how much time do I spend on Facebook every day? And now that I'm left frame, how much work can I catch up on? I've got all these videos that I haven't edited yet. I've got all these other things, like technical problems with my website, which instead of, you know, doing all of those, I've been on Facebook promoting my show and so on and so forth. And it's just like, wow. The thing that I've been pouring so much energy and so much effort into, which I've actually been getting rewards for, is no longer there. So that actually frees me to do all these other things that I previously didn't think that I had time to do. So it turned a negative into a positive. And the internet being cancelled would be the exact same thing for me. Initially, there would be the unbridled rage that I would feel about the loss of my liberty and my ability to broadcast from home and so on and so forth. Then the next thing that would occur to me is how many other things that I can now do because I'm not distracted by doing the internet. I can write novels. I can make documentary films. I can do all of these other things. So it matters not what the New World Order messes with me. I'll rage out at it for a moment, and then I'll rationalize it, accept it, and find a way to keep fracking them.
Well said. And if you were the leader of a country, what would you require of your people? I'll let you answer that, and then we're going to take a break.
If I was the leader of a country, I would pass two pieces of legislation. The first piece of legislation is the Suppression of Scumbaggery Act, which means that if you commit any form of scumbaggery, be that financial scumbaggery, violent scumbaggery, deception scumbaggery, you can be locked in prison. And the second piece of legislation that I would enact would be the Prohibition of Any Further Legislation Act, so that nobody could ever pass another annoying law that has no justification on a piece of paper ever again. Ever again. So, scumbaggery would be suppressed, including the scumbaggery of government legislation. Bingo.
Okay, do you want to just explain scumbaggery so we're all clear?
Everybody knows what a scumbag is, you know? and scumbaggery, as some people might call it, is the actions, motivations, and portents of a scumbag. You know? You ever seen somebody and they're kind of like really not nice people? They're violent, aggressive, obnoxious, or dishonest, or they're a scumbag.
Yep.
That's what scumbaggery is.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure we're clear. So how about we take a 5-minute break and we'll come right back with Vinny Eastwood, and maybe we'll have more questions. And thank you for the questions. You're listening to Awake
Good
Radio.
Questions.
Yeah, excellent. .co.uk and We Roar, WS, and Shaziz.com. And we're going to have
beautiful it is out here. Why don't you say something righteous and hopeful for a change?
Tune in to Awake Radio for your positive waves.
Shaziz.com and We Roar .ws and I hope everybody can hear. I did have the air off on the station identification, oddball, but it should be back up and sound wonderful. So welcome back, Vinny, and thank you for being here.
I'm quite glad to be here. Always like sabotaging other people's radio shows by coming on and shining like a bright light.
Absolutely. And you do a lot for the alternative media community. You are a beacon, a bright light for a lot of people. I guess we can kind of like touch on the fact that we met as a result of an argument on 9/11. And I think it was, and it's a shame it's today and not yesterday, but it's just as well, that we were caught in a conversation, and I think it was on, was it on Skype or on Facebook? It wasn't Facebook.
I don't even recall the conversation in question.
Well, it was a friend of mine, Galen Mertzik, and he was adamant, angry, and it was one of those chat streams. That
this is across email, all these guys are really incredibly abusive and irrational and psychotic, and you know, it's just like they were just attacking me and so on and so forth. And you know, I'm the kind of person that you don't want to attack, not because I'll attack you back and mess up your life or get revenge or anything, but because I'm actually just a really nice guy and there's no freaking point. Why? What the hell is the point? I mean, it's like, oh, look, there's a nice fuzzy chinchilla. Let's kill it.
Was pretty much, and it, you know, it's like, why can't we just agree to disagree? And a lot of people are into this trivium and how to argue and how to be thinking logical and all this other stuff. But if you don't agree with their way of thinking, then you're automatically, like, your opinion means
nothing. I'm COINTELPRO. I'm an agent of the New World Order. Yeah, bro. I'm like, living on the bones of my ass, been doing so for 7 years, getting every freaking activist from here to Timbuktu on my gosh dang radio show 5 days a week, getting no money for it, surviving specifically on the good, decent contributions from ordinary people from my audience who donate and subscribe for $5 a month and so on and so forth, so I can at least finance this operation. Living in a cold place in West Auckland, and having my family abuse me, and you know, people giving me Shiite Muslim 6 ways in 6 days from Sunday, having to block people on Facebook every other day for abusing me after I take screenshots. Of course, I'm actually building an abuse file so on my computer of screenshots of all the abuse that I get on YouTube comments and Facebook and so on and so forth. Yeah, I do all of that because I'm being paid to, bro. Yeah.
Yeah, and you also, you know, did mention that you're unbiased because you'll have, on one day you'll have let's say distilled liquid proponents, and the next day you'll have alkaline water proponents. You know, you have everybody on. You have no bias about who can say what on your radio show. So I think you know, that's probably the biggest attraction to what you do, and that's why we do it here at Awake Radio, because we want to make sure everybody's voice is heard. And it's everybody's voice is important in this conversation. So,
yeah, everybody's got a story. You've heard that saying before, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
And you will find the truth of that statement when you listen to the Vinnie Eastwood show. And if people actually listen to my radio broadcast, I encourage you to listen 5 days a week, because frack me, I've actually saved people's lives with my radio show. One of my listeners emailed my producer like in the first year of my radio show and said that they were about to commit suicide before listening to my show, and realizing that all of this horrible stuff that was happening to them in their life, and all of the thinking that they were doing about the New World Order, how their family was abandoning them and everything like that, and they lost their sense of humor about it, and they were in a very dark place, and then they heard my show, they heard the wisdom, they heard the comedy, and suddenly life didn't seem that bad. So I literally have saved lives with this radio show, and that's one person that's actually emailed us and told us that. There's probably many that haven't. And I remember I was at a protest I think a couple of weeks ago against the government surveillance bill. It was a government surveillance bill protest, the GCSB bill. They're basically passing the New Zealand equivalent of the Patriot Act here, kind of thing, to surveil on everything and everybody does. And one of the protesters comes up to me and he goes, "Vinny, you saved my sanity, man. You know, you I would have gone nuts if it wasn't for your radio show." And he gives me a $100 note. And,
wow.
You know, and he was the second person that day to give me a $100 note out of their wallet to thank me for what it is that I do. And what did that $100 get spent on? Did it get spent on drugs? Did it get spent on liquor? Did it get spent on a strip club or what? No, it got spent on frickin' rent, food, and water, and gas. And you know, that's all I can really afford. I can afford to survive and be mobile, and that's about it at this particular point. I mean, if I was an agent of the New World Order, at least I'd be getting paid a decent wage, you know. It's like, "Vinny, you know, go out and spread some BS and some disinformation and some scumbaggery. We'll give you some money, bro." It's like, oh man, I wish, you know, recruited by the FBI of New Zealand, you know, it'd be wonderful. Ah, I could just sit here and shill BS for a living and get paid a huge wage like all of these other talk radio show hosts in New Zealand do. Like this dude named Sean Plunkett. He gets on this rant against anti-fluoride people and says they're all crazy, they're all nutters, and so on and so forth. Just negative crap. And these people got no information. They got no souls. They got nothing that I want.
Yeah, it's the Bill O'Reilly method.
Yeah, I mean, O'Reilly
just put
you
down
used
and call your names. Go ahead.
Did you know that O'Reilly used to be a conspiracy theorist?
No.
He was a JFK researcher, and he realized how easy it was to manipulate people, how easy it was to lie to them, gain an audience by using pure scumbaggery, and boom, he's number one. Being a conspiracy theorist, ladies and gentlemen, doesn't necessarily mean that you're a good person, because there's an old saying, if you poke your head into hell, some of it comes back with you. And I'm sure many of us have wrestled with the darkness inside ourselves, this psychopathic infection that we fight against on a daily basis. We've, on occasions, hated our family, hated our friends, hated ourselves, along with hating the scumbaggery and the government and all of this other stuff. And sometimes you just got to detach. And upon reflection, you realize that, you know what, actually maintaining my sanity, maintaining my ability to be a good, decent, honorable, caring, balanced, loving person is far more important than all this rage and hate and injustice that I feel.
Absolutely. And I think everything you're saying is just pretty much the opinion of all the people that I'm involved with here at the radio station. We recently, a couple weeks ago, had the Shout from the Mountain weekend where we tried to get you involved. And that was the same weekend, I think, as the chemtrail March or whatever, and it was hard to get a lot of people involved, and we just really wanted people to just make a statement, whether they emailed it, texted, you know, whatever, or they actually wanted to come on, speak live over the weekend, whatever it was. And you actually responded, you know, you've given us some encouragement, you responded, that was the most important thing. And there were so many people, I have like almost 5,000 people on my Facebook page, and I tried to engage some of the most prominent people, and most of them didn't even respond. And I understand, everybody's so busy, it's hard to, you know, pick and choose, like, what should we get involved with. And some people are skeptical, and they don't understand. But the individual, Shaziz, who runs Shaziz.com, Shaziz Radio, and he has Knights of the Round Table, which is a bunch of guys that are involved in alternative energy, and they're actually building Tesla coils. And there's one in Texas, maybe two in Texas, and one in Australia, who are putting the pieces together. Or no, one's in Utah, one's in Texas, and one's in Australia. And they're putting these pieces together, and they want to have a long-distance test. And they're going to test their Tesla coil, but they're having difficulty getting parts. Like, I guess you know, in Australia, it's almost impossible to get things sent there, and it's astronomical in cost because of the distance. And, you know, and these gentlemen are just going above and beyond trying to. And Shaziz woke up one morning having a horrible nightmare. I don't know what it was, but it was enough to prompt him to want to make sure that people understood that these are our children's future that we're talking about, that we don't really have an option anymore. It's time that we have to make sure that we love one another, that we spread the message of peace and joy and love and hope and sharing with one another. And bringing all these internet radio stations together. He actually had about 43 different networks that were simulcasting or carrying the podcast that they had created on that weekend. And it was just an amazing thing to be a part of. And you know, I just think it's a time for us to come together. And I think the more that we're at odds with each other, you know, or try to find fault, you know, try to look at the tiny speck of, what is it, the speck in their eye when you got a, you know, log in yours kind of thing, which I, you know, I don't know how that really fits, but we need to come together. We need to, you know, drop the pretense and stop trying to focus on what's wrong with the individuals and try to find out what's right, that we can do the solutions to make the change in this world for everybody, for ourselves and everybody.
Well, I both agree and disagree with you. Mm-hmm. Number one, infighting is a natural part of this. I mean, you can't wake up a whole bunch of people to the New World Order system and have them previously be part of that system where everybody's infighting, everybody's attacking each other, everybody's having one over on one another, everybody's ignorant, everybody's stupid, so on and so forth, everybody's unhealthy. And then they become part of the truth movement and expect that all of those symptoms will simply disappear overnight. Mm-mm-mm. You bring all of that with you. And people are naive in thinking that you come into the truth movement, which is about peace and love and unity and exposing scumbaggery. And then they suddenly realize that, oh my God, the scumbaggery has followed us here, that there are scumbag radio show hosts, that there are manipulative YouTubers, that there are crazy conspiracy theorists, as opposed to what you would wish is like this beautiful idealistic image of a movement that is all together, we're all one, we're all enlightened, we all know what's going on. Nothing could be further from the truth. We're divided, we're ignorant, we're unrealistic, we're naive, we're all those same things that we were before becoming truthers still. And Dean Clifford said on my show yesterday, and I'll never forget this, says, you know what the reason why all of this is happening is? You know what the cause of all these problems is? You look at that person in the mirror every day. The source of all these problems is you. Absolutely. You alone. It's not the bankers, it's not the politicians, it's not frickin' Monsanto,
It is you. You are the problem. Unless you're willing to solve your own problems yourself, none of these problems are going to be solved. And that's why I don't like it when people infight at the same time as not acknowledging their own faults. Whenever I infight with somebody, I acknowledge the inherent hypocrisy of what it is that I'm doing. At the same time I'm calling out and trying to help people and expose a bit of scumbaggery, I'm hurting people's feelings with the things that I'm saying and accusing them of things that may not well be true because I just don't know, and I'm just flying off the handle because I'm getting too emotional. And unless I'm capable of, like, just... Here's the thing. You ever heard of the ballad of the cosmic schmuck? Cosmic meaning big, schmuck meaning idiot. How do you know if you are the cosmic schmuck? Think about it. If you question to yourself, you know, when, am I the cosmic schmuck? Then it's very unlikely that you will actually be the cosmic schmuck. But if it never occurs to you, if you never question it, if you never wonder to yourself, you know, am I the cosmic schmuck? Then it's quite likely that you might well be. Because without that self-analysis, without that ability to see the faults in yourself and to address them by yourself, without anybody's help, you're the cosmic schmuck. And people forget that. People forget that they're flawed. Okay? I'm willing to admit that I'm an idiot. All right? I may not sound like an idiot. I may sound intelligent and so on and so forth. But I know that I'm an idiot. You know why? Because there are trillions of pages of documents and books and web pages and so on and so forth that I have yet to see. There are billions of thoughts that I have yet to have. There are hundreds of millions of realizations and important life lessons that I have not yet learned. And it's only once you realize to yourself how inadequate your current existence really is, you'll never actually improve yourself.
Well said. And I think after I got over the shock of 9/11 and the political devastation, that was the next thing I learned. I listened to Michael Tesserian, and he talks a lot about the problem is you, you know, that it's not being able to be in touch with your own dark side. And that's basically what you said, and that probably does more to keep this thing afloat than the Monsanto and the medications and the banksters and all this other stuff. That I personally talked to Freeman a few weeks ago, and I said on air, I really think that they put the idea, the picture in our heads, and we give it life. That's what I think. That's what I really believe. And he didn't say yes or no. I mean, I'll have to go back and listen, but I'm pretty sure he agrees with what I'm saying, because everything they mentioned before that kind of stuck in there. But yeah, we live in some incredible times. I feel like I'm privileged to even understand, comprehend this information and of what's going on in our world. But at the same time, you know, I feel confused about how come everybody else doesn't know, and what can I do to make them more aware so we can change this. And I think it's important to always bring it back to what am I doing to keep this construct afloat, you know, to keep this thing moving. And I think that was well said.
Well, you know, everybody seeks to blame others for problems they themselves have and helped cause, you know. Like, you ever had somebody tell you a story? Like, let's say they have a bad interaction with somebody and there was some violence or some theft or some harsh words said or something like that. And they tell you their version of it, and they make themselves look like the victim in all of this, where in actual fact they played just as big a role in this incident as the other person who they're claiming is the bad one. And in the truth movement, is full of that. You know, you've got, like, in Occupy Auckland, for example, there's a activist, 40-year activist, Penny Bright. Wonderful woman. Love her to bits. And she got more experience in activism than any of the other people there, easily.
like the other people who were there trying to sort of co-opt it and control it and so on and so forth had like maybe a couple of years of activism under their belts. They hadn't ever effected proper law change as she had. They hadn't been arrested 22 times and won 21 times in court as she had. They got no experience comparable. And because she disagreed with the way that they were trying to run things, they accused her of being an intelligence agent, even when it is open knowledge that she is one of the of New Zealand's officially listed list of subversives. Okay? And see, this is the thing. You go into it and you're trying to do the right thing and what have you, and if somebody's actually smarter than you, has more experience than you, shows you what you can do to be more effective, and because you're so full of yourself, you don't listen to them, and because they get angry with you, because you're not listening, because you're not being effective, because you're not doing what you can to help people, you see them as the enemy instead of yourself.
Right.
All right? You've got I've got a song that I wrote about a guy named Bruce Montalvo, and one of the lines from it is what was it? You got desire for growth and what you think is right, but not the presence of mind to realize it's yourself that you fight. Poison in your thoughts and polluted words in your cranium. You're more frank and toxic than depleted uranium. There's nothing comparable to yourself around the world. Okay, so you know I'll look at other radio show hosts and try and compare them to myself. Compare and contrast. The reality is that I'm actually taking inspiration from people. And I love my job because I get to talk to inspirational people who are actually doing something right by humanity on a daily basis. Okay? Previous to doing this kind of line of work, previous to this kind of line of thought, the only contact I had with human beings was selling them things or taking orders from them. You know? That was the only social interactions that I really had with people. And I was just thinking to myself, man, how much of a wasted life is that? How much of an antithesis to personal growth and development is that? That's why I quit my slave job. And that's why I call it a slave job. Because if you have to leave your house, get stuck in traffic, go to a job that you hate day in, day out, and you're never actually developing yourself in any way, shape, or form. You're not doing any self-reflection. You're not watching documentaries at home. You're not listening to enlightening radio. If you're just consuming nothing but BS, how could you think that there's anything real about you? Okay? And I think that's the reason why a lot of us truthers get really depressed and upset and angry, is because we don't value our lives as we maybe should have. We're not kind and respectful enough to ourselves to do this. I mean, like, there's 9 words, and they come in threes. My 3 most hated words are, I don't care. My 3 favorite words are, I don't know. And the 3 words I believe are required for real, meaningful, personal development are, I was wrong. If you're willing to say, I don't care, then you're missing out on a value part of your humanity. Mm-hmm. If you're unwilling to say, I don't know, then you're missing out on your ability to learn something. And if you're unwilling to admit I was wrong, then you're incapable of development. It's just that simple.
Beautiful. So, where do you want to go from here?
Do we have questions from the...
wore out my girlfriend. I think April finally got tired because her questions, although they were very insightful... her perspective is of the liberty movement and the free man on the land, so she's very much a constitutionalist. Her knowledge is impeccable. And if you ever wanted to talk to somebody about the Constitution of the United States or any liberty issues like that, she'd either know the person to talk to or she could answer your question and tell you where to find them. And she's even written books. So she's just an amazing wealth of knowledge. And she started her own radio show at We Roar. So she's you know, unmatched in that I know of. I mean, there's other people, I'm sure, that are just as brilliant, if not more stellar. But she's really a wonderful woman in what she does, and she's very focused. So I think that's why her questions were kind of geared in the way that they were. So, but
Well, there was a question one of my listeners asked me, a guy named Vincent, you know, where we went out to a protest together, and he says, oh, you're V1 and I'm V2. Are you thinking what I am, V1? Oh, shit, I hope not V2. And he asked me this question. He goes, you know how I like use humor in my shows, you know, and there's often a lot of laughter. And you'll go to the VinnieEastwoodShow.com archives page and you scroll down. Every time I get somebody on webcam and I make them laugh, or when we're both laughing at the same time, that is the screenshot that I take. Okay? And so you'll scroll down and you will see picture after picture after picture after picture of people laughing their asses off. Okay? Right. And I'm the only one who really does that. I think maybe in history, talking about incredibly serious, scary,
yes,
horrific things that are mind-bendingly complicated whilst laughing your ass off.
Yes.
I mean, comedians have done it, but they don't do it while interviewing people, do they? You know? Bill Hicks, George Carlin, they were fantastic for this, and I credit them as being some of my prime inspirations for the way that I do it. And the question Vincent asked me was, you know, why don't you do... why don't you take things more seriously? Why don't you do this, that, and the other? And I say, well, can I ask you, name me one other radio show who talks about this kind of content where people use comedy as its baseline. He couldn't name me one. And so I said, what you're really asking me is, Vinny, why aren't you doing everything the exact same as everybody else is? You know?
No.
And it's its own answer, isn't it? Because
yeah,
once you fully understand what question it is you're asking, the answers themselves become apparent. And the reason I do this is not necessarily a choice, it's a lack of options. Like when I lost my job, when I quit my job, rather, it was the last job I could really do. You know, have people telling me what to do and so on. And so on. I hate being told what to do. Frickin' hate it. It's probably why I hate cops so much. You know, I mean, I'm friendly to police officers. I have nice conversations with them and so on and so forth. You know, you can go on my YouTube channel and say, Vinny Eastwood forced to stop protesting by police. And the protest lasted about 10 minutes before the cop showed up. And then me and the cop had a nice amicable conversation for 20 minutes. So, and the cop became chief star. And thousands of people watched that. And they loved it because they saw a nice amicable conversation between a protester and a cop. Right? If you can do that at the same time as you're exposing scumbaggery, it means you're a balanced individual. And that's what I really like about myself as a man, is that I am very balanced. I am willing to listen to pretty much everybody. Unless, of course, they're just a fly-off-the-handle remark kind of people. You know, like, the reason why I like Skype, Facebook, and YouTube, the reason why I love them all together, other than the fact that I can use them to get the word out and communicate with people effectively, is they've got a block function. Vinny, I hate you! You're a scumbag! You're a fat faggot! Block! And you never hear from the motherfucker again. You know, like, you know, when you were a teenager and you used to like break out with pimples and you used to get this intense satisfaction when you got a nice juicy fat pimple and you just pop it and you go, ah, yeah, oh yeah, that kind of perverse satisfaction. It's precisely the same thing that happens when I block people on Facebook and YouTube and Skype. Vinny, I hate you. Block. And it's gone. Oh yeah, purged. Oh mate, because hey, look at it this way. How many people on the planet right now? Roughly 7 billion plus. What is the frack is the point when you've got that much choice and that many people that you'll probably never meet? What in the hell is the point in spending a large section of your time arguing with people who don't get it or interacting with people that don't encourage you, don't inspire you, don't help you, don't enlighten you? The hell is the point? Life's too frickin' short. Block and move on. Because I guarantee you, for every one person that you wind up blocking because they're just a douchebag, there'll be another 10 people out there who you'll meet who are really loving and kind and generous and fabulous. Okay? Absolutely. Priorities, people. Priorities. I was talking with... have you ever heard of Rick from Honey Radiance Radio?
Honey Radiance?
Yeah, never mind.
No.
Small little radio show.
I will.
I'm not sure if he's even on air anymore, but he'd gotten into this. This is just a case study to illustrate my point. He's got a chat room, okay, on his radio show. And trolls kept coming into his chat room. And he would derail his entire radio show by trying to address and argue with these trolls constantly. And he was talking to me about this on this radio show, and I say, Rick, what's your priority in life? Is your priority to give your time and your effort to people who are scum, who are wasting your time, who are a waste of effort, or do you want to spend that time and effort on people who are worth it, people who are actually friendly, people who are actually kind, people who can teach you something that you don't already know, people who can actually think rationally? Penny dropped for him, didn't it? Because we're surrounded constantly by negative influences. And as I mentioned with psychopaths earlier, if you keep allowing those negative influences to keep infecting your life on a constant basis, you are disadvantaging yourself. Okay? You are who you associate with. Okay? Right. When I was in high school, I was associating with losers, drunks, drug addicts, dropouts. Incidentally, I became a loser, drug addict, drunk, dropout. Isn't that interesting? And then when I got out of university, when I stopped working, the only people I really chose to associate with were creative people, intelligent people, kind people, loving people, enlightened people, creative people. You know. And suddenly, I've become a kind, loving, generous, intelligent, creative person. Pick yours and pick them well. If they are completely unproductive, if they're not aware, if this is a friend that you've had for 10 years, the exactly where to go, they're okay. All the friends I've ever had in high school, not one of them is a friend of today. And of all the friends that I ever had in university, not one of them is a friend of mine today. And of all the friends that I had in or previous jobs and things that I had, not one of them is a friend of mine today. I've only had one friend who has kind of stuck with me that whole kind of period of time that I was going through university and my work life before I started becoming a truther and everything like that, and that's my mate Jono. And Jono was like me at the time, you know, a bit of a drunk and some real problems kind of adapting to life. And now he's bought his own house. He's really successful at his business. He's got a beautiful daughter, a wonderful wife.
And he is developing himself personally on a constant basis. Whenever he's working, he's listening to self-development tapes and so on and so forth. It's the reason why he's still my friend. Had he not gotten out of that rut that he was in, we would have parted ways long ago. But I knew, based upon his behavior, that he was capable of improving, but he just had a little bit of difficulty. So I was actually kind of his savior in a lot of ways, by helping him to sort of develop himself. And as a result, I helped to actually develop my skills as at the same time, you know, and we were together like a couple of weeks ago or whatever, and stayed up all night and talking and stuff like that. And we both realized that at the first time that we met, that was when both of us were going through the very most horrifically difficult time in our lives, that we both really needed a good, solid friend to be there. And we found each other. It was like finding somebody in the dark.
Synchronistic. Yeah, it's beautiful when that happens. And you did touch on it earlier that you have to love yourself. You have to give that to yourself so you can give it away to other people. And then you attract that beauty within yourself. You know, you attract those kind of people. And the other ones are repelled. They're not hanging around. If they are, they're trying to get into the circle, but they can't really penetrate because you're not resonating with that kind of person, that personality, character, whatever, that essence that's negative or psychopathic or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, we talk a lot about labels, and you know, I try to figure out, like, I want to love everybody. I even want to love those who despitefully use me or use us. And, you know, I don't want to bring them home and, you know, live with them and do all these things. But I want to be able to understand that, like a shark, if a shark bites your leg off because you swam by it and it's hungry, you know, you can't, like, be pissed off at the shark for being a shark. You know, it does what it does. So you got to kind of be balanced, as you said, and understand, you know, what you're dealing with and, you know, move on to what's the next indicated thing, kind of.
Mm.
I don't know. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Well, first of all, I don't understand quite what you mean by that, because if you're swimming by a shark bites you, it's not the shark's fault. Of course it's the shark's fault. He freaking bit you. But you can't ignore your responsibilities. For example, did you know the shark was there? Did you come into that shark's territory? Did you see a fin in the water and go, no, she'll be sweet as, he's probably hunting a fat little seal or something like that. He won't come after me. Were you being naive? You know?
Well, you know, we can go really far with this because when I came into the realization of what's happening in the world, as far as I understand it, I mean, I by no means have all the ends of it, I got really angry. And, you know, I wanted to do something. I wanted to scream and shout, and I wanted everybody to hear me, and I wanted everybody to jump on my bandwagon and let's go together. I protested at the Million Worker March, and I stood there, like, yards away from the White House, and I kept saying to the group that I was with, well, why can't we just go storm there? There's more of us than there are in there, and we could just break into the doors and tear it open and all, you know. And I had that anger and I had that energy, and it wasn't going to benefit me. I would have got locked up. I might have got locked up indefinitely, you know, whatever, and never been able to do the show. But it's just like the shark that bit me, you know. I got angry, but I didn't understand anything that I was dealing with. I mean, even then, I was naive, but I wasn't being naive because I didn't understand the full ramifications. And I could say now I understand better, but I still don't understand all of what's really going on or why it's happening. You know, we try to speculate. I don't think anybody really does understand the full implications of what's happening here on Earth. So it's kind of hard to say that, you know, it was my fault, you know, because I was born into this this world and to this environment and to life as it is, you know, today. But I don't believe that. I think that I become awakened. I keep listening. I try not to form too many opinions about anything, and I keep my mind open, and I connect the dots, and then, you know, literally see how everything is connected, not just people individually, but even the construct of the horrible things. There's patterns that we can see. There's, you know, follow the money, you know, or whatever. You know, we can see how all this is connected. I really wanted to maybe get your opinion about Syria a little bit before we end, because I know you
Before we do, I've got two things to add here. The person who thinks he knows everything obviously knows nothing. The person who believes he knows nothing obviously knows enough. How long did it take you to get indoctrinated into the system? How many years did you spend in kindergarten, preschool, high school, university, postgraduate study, the working world, most of your life, right? And you think that after a couple of years of learning alternative information that you're completely deprogrammed and you know what's going on? Frack no. You have decades and decades of relearning and deprogramming ahead of you, son. Now, yeah. Syria. First of all, it's a serious situation. The way the people are being treated is very sad. You know, it makes me a sad. And
a sad. Me too.
Yeah. It's a very sad situation. And
poor the, sad.
Yeah, yeah. And the person who you want to be talking to about this is freaking Suzanne Posel from OccupyCorporatism.com. Had her on the show the other day with Dean Clifford. Unbelievable. Dig this. Israel has found a massive natural gas deposit with about $700 billion worth of natural gas. And guess who's got a deal with Iraq and Iran to build a pipeline to the sea? And so that they can supply.
Would it?
Syria.
Oh, Syria. They have.
Which
the
would
deal.
Compete. Which would compete with.
Oh, with America. Ah.
So all of a sudden, it becomes very, very clear, doesn't it, ladies and gentlemen? Oh, why do they invade Iraq? For the oil. And a couple of other objectives, of course. Why are they invading Syria? For the natural gas. And a couple of other objectives, of course. It's always the same freaking thing, isn't it? Every single time that the US invades a country, it's because they want to frickin' stop them from competing.
Well, I guess is it just the prime minister there in Syria that's not being agreeable with them, that they want to oust? Or is it more detailed than that?
A little bit more detailed. Of course, there's always more details. Right. First of all, when you're looking at the Syria regime, as they call them, you know, let's cross cut to our Middle East correspondent. Yes, thank you, Finney. Regime, terrorism, terrorism, regime, veiled threat, regime, regime, WMD, terrorism, terrorism, regime. Back to you in the studio. You know, this is the adequate reporting that we're getting out of the mainstream media. It fracks me off to no end. I mean, I would if I wasn't laughing, I'd be freaking crying. Oh God, they're brainwashing everybody. They're gonna try another WMD strike. Oh, there's gonna be weapons of mass destruction. But instead of taking that response, getting depressed, get ridiculously angry, I choose to look at the truth of the matter. Syria has one of the highest educated populations in the Middle East. Did you know that? Did you know that more women go to university in Syria than men? Did you know that they have a hugely successful family unit structure and that divorce is virtually non-existent? Did you know that they get taken care of? Did you know that they don't even have to pay electricity bills and so on and so forth? Did you know that they've got really affordable housing and so on and so forth? No, you didn't know that, did you? You know why? Because nobody freaking reports on that kind of stuff. This evil regime that gives people free electricity and free education and and affordable housing. This evil regime, they're so bad because they use chemical weapons like fluoride to hurt its people. Even though it wasn't actually the Assad regime that did it, it was actually the Al-Qaeda people sponsored by the US. Who incidentally fluoridate their water.
And there was another speculation by Joseph Farrell that said they want to bring in more of the Islamic factions, so they want to make that culture larger, so then they'll have even something bigger to fight against. So it just
Assad is secular, okay?
Right, absolutely.
He's not a religious man, okay? And so when they come out, it's just a whole bunch of BS. Basically, there's two general rules. For life. If you don't know the information, like if you're not actually informed, there's two general assumptions you can follow. If it comes from an official source, it's the direct opposite of whatever that official source is saying.
Right.
And if you can't make it at home by yourself in your kitchen, it's a soft kill by a weapon.
So we'll throw the water on them.
You know, I'm sorry to burst your bubble, ladies and gentlemen.
No, you're not. You're singing to the choir here. Most of the people listening are like, they have your back, Vinny. They're like, they're town for you 100%. They agree with you. We understand these principles. We understand what, in some respects, we're up against. We don't have all the information, of course. That's why we need to rely on each other, in a sense. Each person brings a special piece to the puzzle. But,
Yeah. Well, you know, crazy. We haven't been taught how to think. You know, and we haven't been taught how to listen. We haven't been taught how to problem solve. And so you have to teach yourself all of those things. And incidentally, we haven't been taught how to teach ourselves either. So, you know, It's a frustrating, difficult thing to deal with in life. But hey, look, as long as you're willing to keep working on it, as long as you don't give up, you'll make progress. Okay? And that's all you got to do. You know, analyze yourself. Am I more informed today than I was yesterday? Have I accomplished and have something to show for yesterday's efforts? In most cases, the answer to those questions will be no. I'm just as dumb yesterday as I am today. I've accomplished just as little yesterday as I am today. It's like we're treading water in an ocean of scumbaggery. And it's not cool, man. You know? And there are sharks swimming around us. This is a really terrible situation. But when it comes down to it, like I mentioned with those POWs, you know, you've got to have deep faith, really. You've got to have deep faith that there is something good out there, that you are really powerful, that there is hope. Once you lose hope, that's when you start turning to the dark side, all right?
Fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering.
Now, think about the wise words of Yoda. He knew what the frack he was talking about, didn't he? How many of you out there are afraid? How many of you are out there who are afraid? I mean, really, think about this. Because I hear people talking about this all the time.
Yeah.
Well, see, bravery and courage is not the absence of fear. It is the acceptance of it. And accepting your responsibility at the same time to be brave, to be courageous, to fight for what is right, to tell the truth, even when it doesn't serve your purposes, to accept your responsibilities, even though you wish you didn't have any. That is power. New World Order knows this. They know that when people take control over their own lives, when they stop doing what they're told, when they start doing what they feel, what they know is right, that's when we become very, very dangerous to the establishment. And people need to remember that, because I've seen too many of my fellow truthers turn to the dark side, become too afraid of the New World Order to start up their own radio shows, who become too doubtful of their own ability to put out information that they never even start their own website, who become too disenfranchised with their fellow man that they never attend protests anymore, who become too blissfully ignorant of their own power that they never try to do anything and in fact try to encourage others to do nothing and tell them that their efforts are wasted and as a result they accomplish absolutely nothing. That is the dark side. That is not the good side of you. That is not the best part of yourself. I mean, think about it. You know, here's an example. Take me as an example. Somebody who is trying to give you motivation, somebody who's trying to give you information, somebody who's trying to give you inspiration, versus somebody else who's trying to discourage you, who's trying to get you to shut up, who's trying to get you to give up. Who are you listening to? And this aspect exists within yourself as well. Which part of yourself are you listening to?
Right. Well said. Well, we have about 7 minutes left. And I'd like to give you an opportunity because I know you probably have lots of things scheduled coming up. So, you know, feel free to promote, and give us your websites and your Facebook page and all your little chat groups and all your fan pages, you know. And what
all of which have been disabled.
All
of which
them.
Have been disabled since my... Yeah,
all of them.
Basically. Well, my admin privileges on all of them anyway. So if you contact me through the Vinnie Eastwood fan page, I will never be able to contact you back again. If you go to facebook.com/Vincent.Eastwood, on the other hand, and you contact me there, add me as a friend, that's facebook.com/Vincent.Eastwood. That is the account that I'm now forced to use. Please add me on there. So I've gotten back on the Facebook. That was my old account, and that was my personal one, you know, for the friends and family and music gigs back when I was going out and filming them for a little bit of pocket money and so on and so forth, so I could buy weed. And the other element is I don't understand entirely what my purpose is in life yet, and I'm trying to figure it out. In the meantime, I have a website, thevinnyeastwoodshow.com. That's Vinny with a Y, because it's the most important question. And Eastwood, as in go ahead, make my news. And you can go and check that out if you like. There are all free archives and so on and so forth if you support the work that I'm doing. Basically, if you support me, then by default, you are supporting the entire human race. All right? That may sound really egotistical. It probably is. But I give everybody a platform. You know, even people that I disagree with, I bring them on so that we can hear all of these different voices, all of these different stories, because then you get something which the mainstream media has never given you. Perspective. If you enjoy being enlightened, if you enjoy having a few laughs, if you enjoy knowing that there are people out there who actually care about the sanctity of the human species, then by all means, support the people that are doing it. If you can't do it, like if you've got a slave job, if you've got kids or so on and so forth, you've got two choices. You can either A1, support the people who are doing the work in your stead, like me, like Chrissy, by donating or purchasing products off the websites or whatever, or you can realize that there have been many people throughout history that had slave jobs, had kids, but didn't hide
downstairs,
behind
I was leading
them
the Pentagon
as an
and
excuse
an from the
to
Joint
do
Staff
nothing
call.
While their country and their human race needed them.
Perfect.
Now, on top of that, we have a number of other websites. So we've got thevinnyeastwoodshow.com, my YouTube channel, that's youtube.com/Vincent Eastwood. And we have guerrillamedia.co.nz and, excuse me, and realguerrillamedia.com. www.thedarksideofmetal.com. And I think that's about it in terms of all of that. Self-promotion. Oh, excuse me. Whew, a little bit of a gaseous episode here.
It must have been really good.
Mm-hmm.
That sandwich.